Hello everyone watching at home, this is Adelaide Eternal and we're bringing you our monthly tournament. This time around it's vintage and we are in round 4 of 5 rounds, and you're in the booth with Sarven McLinton, that's me, and Beckett Wolfe.
G'day guys!
Now today, or at least in this round, we're going to be seeing our one and only Beckett Wolfe in action.
Yours truly.
That's right, on the left he's playing Oath. And on the right, we have Jason Rankin playing the white Eldrazi deck. So maybe let's have a look at the deck lists first. So Beckett, maybe you can tell us a little bit about the Oath deck.
Where do I begin? I've been tinkering with this list for a long time. Oath is obviously a classic list, and there's a lot of ways to build it. This I started just with a stock standard list, and just played around with a few of the cards and... You know, you see something like Memory's Journey, which is a 2-mana blue instant. You can shuffle up to 3 cards from your graveyard to your library, and it's got flashback for green. And you're like, oh, at first, before you really know vintage, you're like, oh, why are they playing that card? And you slowly learn, and, you know, there's other options like Gaia's Blessing. And I think when playing vintage, it's just most important to play the cards you like and that you enjoy playing with, because really they're the cards you're comfortable with, and that's the least likely to misplay. As I said before, in earlier videos, you're always gonna misplay at some point, and I think it's just more important to minimize that by playing cards that you're comfortable with. So my list is pretty stock standard. My win cons are Grizzlebrand, Sphinx of the Steelwind, Runescarred Demon. Runescarred Demon was a new addition. The logic was when he enters, you get to Demonic Tutor, so search for a card, and you basically search for Time Walk. And Time Walk again, trigger the Oath again, get another creature. So he's a free 6/6, and sometimes he can search for a Toxic Deluge or something specific. I also splash for the Time Vault Voltaic Key combo, and I've got Tinker in there because Tinker can search for one of those combo pieces. And I also run Sphinx of the Steelwind as one of my big fatties because Sphinx is actually an artifact. So that's the reason Sphinx is in there. It's obviously no Grizzlebrand, but you know, oathing into a 6/6 flying Vigilance Lifelink beater is pretty damn good, and being able to tinker into him for a free win sometimes is also pretty handy.
Nice, and I like your sideboard, still respecting Dredge. We haven't seen Dredge today at the tournament, but they exist, they are in there. We've got Jackson McCall-Pierce rocking Dredge, and we're all expecting that at some point we're going to have to face him, so that's why we're still packing 6, 7, or 8 sideboard cards in there for Dredge, even though we don't see anyone else.
Yeah, I've got 4 Leyline of the Voids, 1 Ravenous Trap, 1 Pything Needle. It might need a bit of work considering there's less Dredge around these days, but you do have to respect it. If you don't have a mass amount against Dredge, then you're just going to lose to the matchup. I like Ravenous Trap because I run Demonic Tutor, and the last thing you want to do is run 4 Leyline of the Voids and think, yep, I've got my Dredge match shored up, and you don't hit the Leyline in opening hand, and then it's really difficult to hard cast, and it's sort of awkward in your hands if you top deck it. I like the Ravenous Trap because you can Demonic Tutor for it, and then it costs 0 mana, so it's a bit of versatility there.
Sweet. So let's have a look at the White Eldrazi deck by Jason Rankin. So this is, whilst I say it's a stock standard list, in reality, all of the Eldrazi players, they have to decide on exactly which of their creatures are 3-ofs, which are 4-ofs, and so on, because they need to tailor it exactly to the metagame. And in this instance, he's rocking 6 different, 6 Thalias, 3 of each of them. And he's got the main deck containment priest, but he's got 3 of them. So it's a very a slightly different build compared to others that run a few less displacers and so on. But displacer, I think Jason Rankin, at the back of his mind, he knew Mentor is going to be out in force today. And in reality, it was. And displacer is really good at killing Mentor tokens.
I haven't seen that many Thalia Heretic Cathars in a while. It's a new sort of card, and it's been played in the land tax legacy deck a lot, and I think it's really good. I really like it. As Sav said, you know, it's a stock standard build, but the way you construct it, which cards go in sideboard, which cards go in mainboard, do you have a better mainboard against the creature decks, or do you have a better mainboard against the blue decks? And as we discussed, every little mana, every little sideboard choice makes a big difference. And Jason's done really well so far, so obviously I think he picked a good list.
Yeah, and he picked the right list to rock up against you, because he's running three Containment Priests in the main.
Yeah, that's tough.
And one in the side, so he's ready to, if you're not aware of that interaction, every time that Beckett goes to trigger his Oath of Druids, so even though he will normally be able to flip cards off the top of his deck until he hits a big fat creature, when he does trigger it, Jason Rankin's going to flash in the Containment Priest, because it has flash, and it's going to say any creatures that would normally come into play from ways of not being cast, not from your hand essentially, so from your deck or from your graveyard, they would get exiled instead. So not the best spot to be in. As much as you love filling up your graveyard for no particular value, the exiling creature clause is pretty big.
Yeah, look, I expect it sideboard, and there was a long time when they were being played in sideboard, and I was like, you know, that's annoying, but you have to expect something, some kind of hate, but when they run mainboard, that's just rude.
Yeah, that's pretty rough. So let's see how it all pans out, and I think that it all depends on who's on the die roll. I mean, if Jason is on the play and he starts off with some kind of taxing effect, it's pretty strong. But if he's on the draw, you can set up quite nicely. You can end up playing a land and a Mox and then an Oath of Druids and hopefully being able to counter the possible Containment Priest. So who's on the play in this matchup?
I think I'm on the play here, and I get a pretty sweet opening hand.
There we go. So we've got a Mox and a land, so you're ready to start the game with two mana and have multiple Force of Wills back up. But the Containment Priest is in the opposing side, and I believe it's a Cavern of Souls, so making things uncounterable.
Oh, okay. Am I on the drop? I can't remember anymore. Didn't happen that long ago, but
I think if your opponent is playing Cavern of Souls and Artifact and then a Containment Priest, it's pretty bad for you.
There we go, I'm on the draw. But
here's the Eldrazi Temple, which taps for two mana for Eldrazi creatures, and but he doesn't do anything, so just mocks Emerald. And he sick top decks the Black Lotus.
I did sick top deck the Black Lotus, and at that point I was pretty sure I won. Black Lotus, it's a classic move, the Ternan Lotus Jace, but it is scary because blue decks can force it and you lose the card advantage against Eldrazi. Ugh, it's free reign, right?
Yeah, I've definitely kept my share of Lotus, Mox, Jace Mind Sculptor, no land hands, and had that forced. It's a brutal situation.
I did also just hit a call off... off the brainstorm.
Isn't this why we play Vintage? I mean, why would you want to play Eldrazi when you can play Ancestral Recall, Jace Mind Sculpt to turn one? It is pretty much living the dream right now. But is it going to be enough? I mean, Jace Mind Sculptor gets attacked. It's not
true.
Ideal.
But he can, you know, unless it's Reality Smash, you can unsummon and just annoy them a lot. It can feel like that when you're playing Eldrazi and you see Acol, you're like, that's an unfair card, you know? Why aren't I playing that? And then when you're playing, you know, four Preordains in your deck and they have a Trinisphere, you go, that's an unfair card. Yeah. Why aren't I playing that?
And here, the exact culprit you were talking about, there's
he didn't
your
have the cavern,
smasher,
though, unfortunately. I think he had to go for it. It's one of those plays we were talking about where he has to take the risky play.
Yeah, more aggressive, but he just needs to hope that you didn't hit the Force of Will and be able to kill your Jace, but unfortunately you did. And is this the point at which you cast Ancestral, not before you Force of Willed the creature?
No, I'm pretty happy pitching Memory's Journey. It's pretty much horrible, dead in hand. And, you know, the reason the Journey's there is it's got the flashback, and I really only want to have it in the bin after I've activated Oath of Druids. So, yeah, it's just force bait.
Ooh, I like it. So, you've just refilled your hand now. You're about to refill it even more with another Jace activation, I assume. Here we go, brainstorm. And Jason Rankin's going, why am I playing creatures again? this is a situation where the Eldrazi deck looks bad, and you go, why are you rocking up with a legacy deck? But in reality, this this situation is not the usual situation that blue decks will be in against Eldrazi. Usually they'll be in a very sorry state of affairs where they've got a Thorn of Amethyst on the opposing side or a Thalia sitting there and making all your spells cost one more, and you're dirtling there with three mana out and having to pay two of it to cast a spell and not use the other one. It's definitely not the typical Eldrazi game here.
And as great as Jace looks, I've since playing this tournament thinking I might actually want to take him out, just because my deck runs Forbidden Orchid, which is a main, you have to run it. It's a land that taps for any color, and it gives your opponent a creature, which lets you activate or trigger Oath of Druids, which says whenever your opponent has, in your upkeep, if your opponent has more creatures, you get to flip cards from the top of your library, which go to discard until you hit a creature, and that creature comes to play. So you need to run the land, but giving the lands to the opponent, giving the 1/1s to the opponent lets them kill your planeswalkers pretty easily, so it can be a bit awkward with Jace. I mean, he's great in situations like this, but I'm just going to test it without him for a little while, I think.
Mm. So Jason now having to make the decision. There's an active Jace on the field. He's got a Cavern of Souls. He has to name only one thing. He has a Containment Priest in hand, but he's probably thinking, well, am I going to win by playing my 2/2 and stopping an Oath trigger when you don't actually have Oath out? He might just need to name an Eldrazi and then just continually play Eldrazi from here on out. It's very difficult.
Yeah, it's not a nice spot for Jason to be in. I don't think you can really criticize his plays too much. The Jace really complicates things. I mean, do you bash the Jace or do you just try to race the face? That's bash the Jace or race the face.
That's now the phrase.
And I think his name's Human here, so I can't counter it. I've got Mana Drain in hand, which would have felt pretty good. But, you know, again, I've got Jace out. I can unsummon that or just brainstorm again. And there we
I'm summoning it and then starting to go bonkers because you've got so many cards in hand is a nice situation to be in. And is that a Demonic Tutor?
It is Demonic Tutor.
Very nice. So what do you find here? I mean, you know, and we're going from the point of view of getting to understand
really,
your plays.
This is fresh. I can't really remember.
Oh, he gets Oath. That's what he got. I'll tell you that. You got Oath.
Oath's pretty good.
And Forbidden Orchard.
I think it's because I sick-ripped the Forbidden Orchard just there. Normally, yeah. I don't actually love searching for Oath if I don't have the Orchard. You know, it doesn't do anything if you don't have the Orchard. It's not the best spell in the deck, necessarily. Yeah. So here, if you've got the Orchard, you've got it.
Yeah, you've given your opponent one creature to allow you to trigger Oath, not even giving him the choice of whether or not to play a creature.
But here, like, that's relevant, you know, that Jason summon, the 1/1 bash, you know. Mm. Jason almost dies there if one of my other lands was a Forbidden Orchard from the start.
So Thalia comes out baiting your Force of Will. This is a very nice play from Jason because he has the Cavern of Souls set to Human. So he could cast Thalia here and resolve it. But what he really wants to do is cast Containment Priest and have that be uncounterable. So he's making a really nice play here to force you to counter it.
Yeah, it's pretty smart. I think I knew what he was up to, but of course, you know, if I let it resolve, it's uncounterable anyway. So
there's a situation here where I play Containment Priest main phase in your own main phase because you untap and you could have some kind of, you could have hard cast Mindbreak Trap. You could have, there's a lot of nasty things that could happen.
Few nasty pasties.
Yeah, I would like to cast Containment Priest in my main phase when you're tapped out. Because I'm going to do it anyway, so don't let you have mana open for it.
Yeah, he's just reading the Oath. I think he's trying to figure out if he's allowed to do it with the trigger on the stack. He is. Oath gets a bit complicated with the ruling because the Oath actually won't trigger if we have the same amount of creatures, so it never goes on the stack for you to respond to it. So you can only respond to it if it goes on the stack, and it only goes on the stack if there are an imbalance in creatures. In this case, there is an imbalance in creatures, so it did go on the stack. Containment Priest responds to it, and I may or may not. I do not have to, but I elect to start discarding, and I do that because even though my creature exiles, I'm happy to have a big graveyard because I have Yawgmoth's Wheel in hand. And even if I didn't, there's a really good chance I'll draw it, and I run Treasure Cruise, Dig Through Time, so having a big graveyard is usually pretty helpful to me, so I'm happy to trigger Oath even with the Containment Priest out.
Yeah, it's nice. So, this is a very awkward situation for you, obviously, with the fact that you need to decide now whether Jace Fate Seals or Brainstorms.
Well, as it turns out, if we remember back to turn one, I did have the Black Lotus.
Ah, yes, the Black Lotus in the graveyard.
And as I said, triggering that Oath, look how relevant it is here. It does get me the game because I've got Time Vault and Voltaic Key.
So you cast Black Lotus, cast Time Vault, which comes into play tapped, but then you can cast Voltaic Key That's to right. untap it and give you infinite turns.
And we've seen this combo before, and I run it as well. So, that just goes to show that triggering, you know, a lot of people might say, oh, well, he's got the Containment Priest and I don't want to lose my creature, but I run three big fatties in the deck, so I'm happy to lose one of them and expect that the other two will get there, and having that big graveyard is really relevant, so obviously it's one here. Technically, I misplay here because I should have just, the Jace is a win con.
Yeah, just tell your opponent I'm going to ultimate Jace on you. But that isn't actually a win con, to be honest, because you'll make his hand go into his library, and then you'll have to give him a turn.
That's true.
So technically it's not a win con, but it is in...
Well, I could ultimate him twice, though. I could get him up so high and then neg him twice, couldn't I?
Well, you have to give a turn to them for them to draw some cards. So what you want to do is ultimate him and then cast Ancestral Recall on your opponent. now that is an actual...
I think I already scooped that A call from turn one. I think Sarv, but no, this is me. I've already won the game. Yeah. Really, we should just be going to game two here. But
this is good because Jason's making you play it out to see if you accidentally give him any additional information,
which you do
with the a Pernicious Deed, which is an enchantment that's. You can pay X and sacrifice it to destroy everything that costs X or less.
It's pretty relevant as well, I think.
And in the meantime, Jason's just using this time to go through a sideboard. It's great because it's just he's able to make efficient use of the time, whereas you have to use up your mental effort.
And then he sees me look at his top card at bottom, and now I'm actually getting information off him if I continue to Fate Seal, because then I just bottom every single card. I get to see every card he's running. So he goes, okay, more information for you. I'll just scoop, which he does. So we go to game two.
Yeah, that seems correct. So tell us about what you sideboard in here.
Sideboards for Eldrazi for me are tough. I have to have something to it. To be honest, the best thing in my deck is the main board Oath of Druids. That's the best spell in my deck against Eldrazi. And as Sarven said in previous videos, you know, we really need to respect that Vintage is in a different place than it was before, and there are creatures now. I get away with it because my Oath of Druid is quite good against creatures normally. So I can get away with it a bit, but I've still got two Dismembers in the sideboard and one Toxic Deluge in the sideboard, which is strictly there for creatures. The Dismember's there because it neg 5, so their biggest thing is Reality Smasher. It hits that.
And, I know that we've had many discussions. And
we have.
I've talked about the fact that in Vintage... I used to be running not white, everything but white, you know, and I'm playing Gush and I'm playing Fast Bond. I'm just, you know, getting to have one of those great, you know, interactive control decks that have great combo finishes. But the issue was every single time I'd go up against Eldrazi, I would lose because their taxes would stop me allowing to Tendrils win, and their creatures would not be killed by any of my removal. I mean, what removal? What kind of removal did we play back in the day? Mm. We play one Lightning Bolt in your deck, one Fire and Ice. It's just not enough. So when I made the move to playing Swords to Plowshares, I just suddenly agreed with every single pro that was saying it for the many, many months and years before, saying that Swords to Plowshares, if you're playing a control deck, you should be running Swords to Plowshares. If you're running Swords to Plowshares, you're running white. And if you're running white, you're running Monastery Mentor, because, and if you're running Monastery Mentor, you don't need to run Tinker. So it just became a very linear decision for deck building for me. As much as I enjoy the deck that I'm playing, obviously we can go on about how format diversity is restricted slightly by that, but we still get creativity within our archetypes. So you'll see so many different breeds of Mentor. Now on the topic of Swords to Plowshares, we had a discussion about how you should play white and play Swords to Plowshares, but then we realized that white doesn't add anything to your deck, so what Swords to Plowshares replacement could we have? We went through a variety of things. We went through Vendetta, we went through Doomblade and so on.
Snuff out. There's that new one, Fatal Push, but it doesn't hit the Reality Smasher, unfortunately.
And inconsistently hits Thought Not Seer, depending on whether or not you have a fetch land. So we went through all these different iterations, and we just decided that Dismember is exactly what you want.
That's right. Dismember, it was good. I tested it a bit. It was quite good. Instant speed, it hits the Silly Containment Priest, and I can cast it off a Soul Ring. So if I go turn one Soul Ring, you know, yes, I can pay the black if I want to gain a bit of extra life, but worst case scenario, you know, I can hit it with any of my lands, really. It doesn't matter. I've also got Dread of Night in my sideboard, and that's, I'm really liking it. I'm signing in against Jason today because he runs Thalia's Guardian of Thraben, and it just straight kills that. So maybe it sounds like, oh, card disadvantage, but it's just straight kills them, makes them completely dead in hand. It reduces the clock of the Containment Priests and his big Thalia's as well.
And the Eldrazi Displacer.
Displacer, which is relevant against a creature deck. I've also got in my sideboard for Monastery Mentor, because obviously...
That's the main reason.
That's the main reason. I mean, they can get big enough to prowess, but as soon as the turn's ended, they're dead. So it really nulls the Monastery Mentor decks a lot. I think I put in an Abrupt Decay or two, maybe even a Nature's Claim, just because it's better than Misdirection and Mental Misstep.
Yeah, and Nature, I mean, if you've got bad cards to take out, it's not a problem to bring in Nature's Claim. There are times where your Eldrazi opponent is mana screwed and killing their soul, you know, mana crypt or some kind of mana producing rock is relevant, but usually you're using it on yourself, because gaining four life is relevant.
Gaining four life is relevant. You know, it might be the difference between a turn and, but as you say, you know, hitting even a Mox of theirs is sometimes better than nothing. It's better than a Misdirection. I can't really think what Misdirection hits unless he's siding in Swords to Plowshares, and that's the one that always gets me. I'm like, are they siding in Swords to Plowshares? Because sometimes the logic is, don't side in Swords to Plowshares, because if I've got Grizzlebrand, I've already won.
Mm-hmm.
And sometimes they side it in. And then I'm not sure, do I want to keep it because of my mental missteps? I'm not sure.
Is this a turn one Oath hand that you have?
This is a turn one Oath.
Mox Sapphire.
Yeah, it's not bad.
Forbidden Orchard, Oath of Druids. You're running hot today.
It's great.
But it is three Oath of Druids hand?
It's three Oath of Druids. I've got an Acol though. Weird. And I've got the Orchid.
Okay, so a very fast hand from Jason. He's already got the Eldrazi land, so it taps for two mana for Eldrazi. And out comes Thalia. This is the one thing you don't want to see.
This is just awful.
Your explosive turn one hand became a non-explosive turn three hand.
It's crazy. I mean, you know, if you looked at my hand from the start, you would have thought, wow, Beckett's just got this game in the bag. I mean, he's playing against a creature deck that struggles to deal with Oath of Druids, and he's got the turn one Oath. And just look at it. You know, Thalia does work.
And you did draw a strip mine.
I even hit a land, which is probably a good draw against Thalia to hit that extra land.
Yeah, if your opponent didn't play a turn one creature, you can just strip mine their land. If you didn't have the oaths, obviously you've got a nice linear strategy there.
Yeah, stripping's quite nice against them.
And he respects that, so he kills your land too. And Thalia's consistently denying mana for you here.
That's right. I reckon Jason's probably going to be pretty scared of the Oath, actually, even if he doesn't know my hand.
He just wants to make sure that you don't.
Yeah, and there's the Nature's Claim, which I can cast.
The Forbidden Orchard is a bit of an issue here, given that it's going to give your opponent a little bit slightly faster clock, but it just depends on when you need to actually tap it. You're going to wait as long as possible, I assume. And here's Reality Smasher. So this is an extremely fast clock here. For those who haven't seen Reality Smasher, it is a 5-mana 5/5, and it has Trample and Haste. And you normally think that's enough, but in addition, if you try and kill him, you have to discard a card, otherwise it counters your removal spell.
Yeah, and I A-call in response. I didn't want to A-call in my turn because I think I'd have too many cards and how I have to discard. But I A-call in response there to try to find a Force of Will. I didn't find it. Got a bunch of cards in hand now, and it's not looking great. I think I actually hit the Black Lotus, but because of the... Is that Black Lotus in my hand?
Well, you can pay 3 here and just cast Oath, but if you do so, you would die to second Reality Smasher.
That's
but
true.
But on the board, you have there's exactly 8 power.
Yeah, so...
So you would go to 3, or 2, because you have to crack a fetch land. So you, aside from Reality Smasher, you can resolve Oath of Druids, go to your turn, and hope to get something.
Yeah, so... Obviously, you just want to fetch and play the Oath of Druids here and say, yep, I'll take the damage and not pay this silly tax, because who wants to lose a Black Lotus for nothing?
Jason is more than happy for you to pay 1 mana for your Black Lotus.
Yeah, and it feels really gross to do this, but I think this is the correct play. I play the Black Lotus, and then I crack it, paying 3 for Oath of Druids. And I'm doing this to keep up Nature's Claim, to claim my own mocks, because if he does have a Reality Smasher, I don't die to it.
Yeah.
And, you know, so I could just tap out for the, Oath and play the risk, but the Nature's Claim isn't doing much in this game otherwise.
Cavern of Souls, I wonder what that will name. I'm going to name... it's usually either human or Eldrazi in this.
I think he's named Eldrazi.
So... Yep, looks like an E on there, so Eldrazi. He loses some life from Ancient Tomb, and there it is. So this is the exact play that you were playing around. So
that's
normally
exactly right.
People will go, well, let's just hope that we fade your Eldrazi Reality Smasher draw step and do the sensible play and keep a Lotus, but you actually burnt the Lotus so that you can make this play.
Yeah.
So you're using Nature's Claim on your own artifact, which says destroy target artifact or enchantment, and the owner gains 4 life. Usually it's the downside, but in this case it's the upside. Jason, more than happy for you to sacrifice your own artifact and lose a card.
Yeah, normally you don't care about the 1 life, but I got a 1 here.
You went up to 14, and then you took 13 damage, so you went to 1.
Yeah.
But now you get to trigger your Oath of Druids. Just check to see if your opponent has more creatures than you. I think Jason Rankin has more creatures than
only,
you.
Only just, yes. Yes,
but so turn your deck around.
I need to hit Time Warp though, and there's the Time
Warp.
So my heart sunk when I saw that, because the Toxic Deluge doesn't do it anymore because I don't have enough life. You know, even if I hit a big fatty, I think he just has the damage to go through it, because I block 1 Reality Smasher. And
so,
gain
yeah.
6 life here. Even if it was Grizzlebrand, I gained 7 life. And, I had to hit Time Walk off the draw. And if I hit Time Walk off the draw, I think I'd be okay. Because then I get 1 bash in, I get a 7, I get a second creature.
Well, you got to play to your outs.
Yeah,
Jason doesn't mind. He goes, you can have us. So Sphinx of the Steel Wind is a 6/6 lifelink flying vigilance protection from red and green. So it's usually protection from Ancient Grudge type effects, but in this instance, he just is able to attack around it. So he has 14 power on the board with just only what's on the board, and you have a 6 power blocker that's going to gain you 6 life. So you're on a proverbial 7, and it removes 1 Reality Smasher. So you're on 7, and the attacker is still attacking for 9.
I mean, geez, he does work, the Sphinx. He blocks the biggest thing, and he kills it, and he... gains your life, but it just wasn't enough, unfortunately, because Jason Rankin has lethal on board if I don't have anything here. It doesn't take long for me to figure out that I have exactly 0 outs left in my deck, especially with a Thalia out. And it just goes to show how strong the deck is. I mean, a lot of these blue decks can that run four ponders and run Brainstorm and Jace, you know, they can just manage these ridiculous hands where you find an out, but the Thalia taxing every turn, it's just too much. And as it turns out, the mass of Eldrazi here is way too much, and the Sphinx isn't enough. Even if I hit Grizzlebrand, I don't think it would do it. Maybe if I hit, you know, I was hoping really for Runescarred Demon, because it's not just one draw off the Time Walk. If I hit Runescarred Demon, I can search for the Time Walk. But I didn't hit it, and yeah, is it a bit of overkill here from Jason Rankin? He's flickering my Sphinx, so the Sphinx comes back tapped, and I scoop to that. So we go to game three,
and that's why Eldrazi Displacer is good, right? It just has the ability to get rid of their blockers. If they happen to be tokens, they go away. And there's that cute little interaction where Eldrazi Displacer says, exile target creature, then return it to the battlefield tapped. And Containment Priest says, creatures can't enter the battlefield unless they were played from your hand. So when you have the two together, it's actually a combo that just says, three mana, kill your creature.
Yeah, it's pretty strong and it's cute, but it works. And the trick with playing cute synergies like that is the cards need to be good by themselves. In this case, obviously, Containment Priest is a great card. You see it in sideboards a lot. And, you know, playing in a sort of hate bear style with the Thalias means you got those sideboard cards in mainboard and you can just ruin decks like mine. And there's plenty of other decks that run it, the same kind of thing, like Show and Tell or something like that. And also, obviously, the Eldrazi Displacer is good by itself, as it is an Eldrazi card, so you can get it in cheap with those Ancient Tombs and the Eldrazi Temple.
Mm. So, this is the decider, is that right?
This is the decider. I think I changed up my sideboard a bit here. I didn't like the Preordains, and so I took the Preordains out, I think.
Yeah, whenever I see these decks that have Thorn of Amethyst in them that taxes your non-creature spells for one, I can't get Gataxian Probe out of my deck fast enough. So I can totally understand if you're hinging on four Preordains in the deck, you got to take one out, two out, something like that.
Yeah, and I think I was pretty disappointed in that. I looked at my opening hand and I thought it was a sure thing, and it just goes to show how strong and linear the Eldrazi is when it's on the play.
Mm.
But I'm on the play on this one, so I think in testing this, it was pretty much 50-50. You know, I would be scared of Eldrazi, and I think Eldrazi would be scared of me. And I think a lot of it revolves around resolving the Oath of Druids. Mm. So if I can get that Oath of Druids out, I'm looking pretty strong.
Well, if you had the hand you had in the last game, it would be pretty nice for you here. But it just goes to show that power of that of the being on the play, where Eldrazi, which is fundamentally a legacy deck. And arguably, you know, in some ways people say it's a worse legacy deck because you could only have one chalice in it, whereas in legacy you can play four. And
mind you, you know,
the soul land, the soul effect from land moxes
and lotuses good. Are pretty strong, and this mana crypt is as well is pretty strong. He's not running mana vault though, which I find surprising. I would have thought mana vault's pretty decent since you've got a lot of colorless, you know. The main problem with Mana Vault is that it's producing colorless mana and
it doesn't untap. The
issue Soul Ring, though? Soul Ring. Why not Soul Ring?
Well, we've actually had a discussion about this, and neither of us that's a nice hand. Neither of us are professional Eldrazi players enough to know why Soul Ring is not played, but we assume that it's simply because it doesn't lead to explosive starts, it leads to explosive turn twos. Rather than explosive turn ones, whereas Mana Crypt is a lovely turn one play.
Yeah, and he's got Mana Crypt here, so we'll see the power of it. He starts off with Thalia, and
Cavern of Souls, yeah, human.
So and I had the Force of Will as well, so it's pretty frustrating that, you know, I kept a really good hand. I'm fetching in response because Thalia reads that both creatures and non-basic lands enter tapped now. It's a great card in Vintage, obviously, because pretty much all the lands are non-basic. And it's very good against me because if I hit a big fatty, he's going to enter tapped. So it's going to give the Eldrazi player an extra turn of bashing in. So it's really strong.
Yeah, I like it. It really, really slows down the control decks that are predominantly non-basic lands, occasionally have a single island in them.
And you can just see how that one little tax makes such a difference. I have Mana Drain in my hand here, and obviously if that land was able to enter in untapped, I could keep up Mana Drain here. And it's just ugly where I just keep getting a turn and turn behind because then I can't counter the taxing effect the next turn because I'm taxed and, yeah. You know, this constant...
Yeah, it's the story of the these tempo, you know, or aggro tempo or death and tax style decks where it's all about keeping you one land behind or keeping you one turn behind. And it's using the Delver principle that, I'm not sure if you heard this one, where Delver is all about holding your opponent's head underwater for just long enough for them to drown.
Yeah, that's right. Trinisphere is a sideboard card of Jason's, and I think he was right to side it in.
Do you feel like you're drowning yet? All of your spells cost 3.
I feel pretty much at the bottom of that forefront of that tropical island right now. Just
with Thalia holding your head under the water
right
now.
That's it.
And Trinisphere looming above the surface.
It's also very interesting to note that how relevant the power toughness is. We also tested White Hate Bears, which is very similar to this list, but instead of running the Eldrazi, it just runs more sort of Thalia effects, more Containment Priest style things.
Leon and Arbiter.
Yeah, that's blah, blah, blah. It did all the taxing right, but the clock, the relevance of that extra power in Thought Not, the bigger Thalia and Reality Smash is super relevant. And just 3 damage a turn here from the big Thalia makes a big difference. I think if this was small Thalia, I'd be under a bit less pressure.
The way that I've seen the Eldrazi deck is imagine an amazing world where your Hate Bears deck are no longer bears, they're 4/4s and 5/5s. That's essentially why Eldrazi is so good. The clock is so fast while still being hateful and
so classic. It means you don't need to hard lock out your opponents, you only need to soft lock them because the clock's relevant and it's not gonna matter if they can eventually find a way out of it because you've killed them. And you know, a Reality Smash is a 5/5, that's a 4 turn clock by itself. Take out fetching, take out a few cheeky beats of a Containment Priest, and you know, you can have someone dead in 3 turns.
So is there a decision that's being made at the moment? Is this this is during...
Well, I can't do much because of Trinisphere.
So you've just passed back, I assume.
I think, yeah, Jason's just wondering whether or not to waste and doesn't...
He obviously doesn't have a Thought Not Seer or something. He's really just going for the mana denial plan and saying, yeah.
I think
I'm
he wasn't
hold you
sure
on Trinisphere.
Which mana to waste. I think he knew he wanted to waste, and since he's scared of the Forbidden Orchids, he wants to hit that. Mm-hmm. But maybe because the Trop was untapped, but I can't think it matters too much because Trinisphere's, I'm not going to do anything for a while anyway. I mean, even if I hit Moxes.
And you miss the land drop. So that's really what he was looking for. He's saying, even my 3/2 Thalia can end the game if you don't get to 3 mana.
That's right. He's got Mana Crypt out, but he's only going to take 3 damage every other turn, and I'm going to take 3 damage every turn, guaranteed.
And there's another wasteland.
A third wasteland.
This is the way that these hateful decks play out, and it's the way to stay competitive in Vintage. If your opponent's doing broken stuff, stop them from doing broken stuff. Leave them in their hand. Let them... there we go. There's a handshake. Writing was on the wall there. After Trinisphere into Wastelands.
Even if I hit 3 lands, the clock's there, so I can't do anything.
Well, that was an interesting matchup, and It was probably 50-50 on either side, and I mean, you had your explosive turns, and Jason also had the consistently taxing and locking effects. So thank you very much for everyone watching at home.
Thanks, guys. So obviously, I'm Beckett Wolfe, and that's McLinton, and we're Adelaide Eternal. So thanks for watching. We've got one more round of this tournament.